In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. In 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 14, St. Paul says, "Now thanks be to God, who always leads us in triumph in Christ." Thanks be to God, who always leads us in triumph in Christ. St. Paul is saying that the believers are always walking in triumph in Christ. It's like procession in which the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the victor, who is went in order to be victorious and to conquer his enemies, and we are walking in this procession, and always we are in this procession of triumph in Christ. And when we think about this verse, maybe we feel it doesn't apply to my life, because many times we feel defeated. For example, we feel defeated when we are conquered by a sin. When sin controls me, I feel defeated. Or we feel defeated when there are some hardships from outside. Or some of us feel defeated before diseases, especially terminal diseases or diseases that cannot be healed or cannot be cured. Many people feel defeated before the loss of loved one. How can we bring them to life back? Many of us feel defeated when feeling of grief, sorrow, depression controls us. But here St. Paul is saying exactly the opposite. St. Paul is saying that we are always, God always leads us in triumph in Christ. God always leads us in triumph in Christ. So, how St. Paul felt that God always leading us in triumph. St. Paul actually had many experiences in which we expect him to feel defeated or failing. But actually, St. Paul, in these experiences, he looked beyond the defeat, beyond the failure, and he saw the hand of Christ making out of this negative experience triumph, victory, making out of this defeat strength and conquer. That's why he said, "Thanks to God, who always leads us in triumph in Christ." And actually, I will share with you some incident in the life of St. Paul and his ministry, in which we expect him to feel defeated, but he did not feel defeated or failing. The first incident that I will share with you, actually, is the incident in which St. Paul said, "But thanks be to God, who always leads us in triumph in Christ." As I told you, this was written in 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Let me tell you the background story of this verse. In what context he said this verse, "Thanks be to God, who always leads us in triumph in Christ." St. Paul established the church in Corinth, and immediately after he left Corinth, he heard many, many bad news about this church. Church was full of problems. He heard that there is division in the church. Some people saying we are after St. Paul, and some people say we belong to Apollos. There was also another division because of the use of the gifts, the gift of tongue and other gifts. There was problem concerning people, conflict between believers, and actually the filing cases against each other before civil courts. Many, many problems, many issues. You can read about all these problems in 1 Corinthians. But actually there was a big, big problem in this church, bigger than all what I mentioned. What was this problem? A man in Corinth committed adultery with his father's wife. And St. Paul, when he heard this report, he was very, very troubled. Because it is a new church, and sin like this will defile this church and will make the atmosphere is not spiritual. And even, as he told them, even the Gentiles who do not know God did not commit such adultery or such sin. And St. Paul, he sent them a very harsh message. And he told them, all of you, you must have been weeping right now because of what happened. Instead of just fighting with one another, you should be weeping right now. And also, you should put away this person from among you. Because don't you know that a small leaven can leaven the whole bread? And St. Paul actually sent them a letter, and as we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, he excommunicated this person, and he, as we read, he said, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, when you are gathered together, along with my spirit, with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ, deliver such a one to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. And all the church actually was sorrowful because of this. And all the church actually grieved. Especially this man grieved abundantly, the man that was excommunicated. And definitely, if we want to evaluate the condition in this church, in the Church of Corinth, we cannot see any triumph there. We cannot see any victory there. We see failing ministry. The ministry of St. Paul actually is failing. Many problems in this church, many division, sins, public sins, excommunications. So we say, this church is failing. So, after this person repented and grieved abundantly over his sin, the church in Corinth sent to St. Paul asking his permission to restore this person to the church again, to accept him again after his repentance. And they were not sure whether St. Paul will accept him or not. And St. Paul sent to them the second letter to Corinthians. And in chapter 2, actually, he addressed this issue. And he told to him, if anyone has caused grief, has not grieved me, but all of you to some extent, his punishment, which was inflicted by the majority, is sufficient for such a man, so that in the contrary, you ought rather to forgive and comfort him, lest perhaps such a one be swallowed up with too much soul. Therefore, I urge you to reaffirm your love to him, for to this end I also wrote, that I might put you to the test, whether you are obedient in all things. Now whom you forgive anything, I also forgive. For if indeed I have forgiven anything, I have forgiven that one for your sakes in the presence of Christ, lest Satan should take advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his demands. So St. Paul actually told them, if you forgive him, I forgive him. Accept him, be compassionate with him, show compassion, reaffirm him, reaffirm your love to him. And then after he said this, he said, now thanks be to God who always leads us in triumph in Christ. So what triumph you are talking about? Yes, there was problem as a problem to solve it. But how can you see there is triumph here, there is victory here? He said in chapter 7, he answers this question clearly. He told them in verse 8, for even if I made you sorry with my letter, the harsh letter that I sent to you, I do not regret it, though I did regret it. So it's confusing, did you regret it or not? Definitely as a father, he regretted writing such a letter to them. But why he did not regret it? Because of the fruits of this letter. He told them, now I rejoice, not that you were made sorry, but that your sorrow led to repentance. For you were made sorry in a godly manner. And then in verse 10 he said, for godly sorrow produces repentance leading to salvation, not to be regretted. Verse 11, he explained how this incident led to triumph. He told them, observe this very thing, that you sorrowed in a godly manner, what diligence it produced in you, what clearing of yourselves, what indignation, what fear, what vehement desire, what zeal, what vindication. In all things you proved yourself to be clear in this matter. So St. Paul actually is telling them, this incident which brought sorrow and grief to the heart of everyone, but when we put this incident in the hand of God, God made it part of the procession of triumph. Because this sorrow produced in you desire, indignation, diligence, fear, vehement desire, zeal, vindication. It produced in your heart all these wonderful virtues that help you to repent, repentance leading to salvation with no regret. That's why thanks be to God who leads us in triumph in Christ. So St. Paul actually is saying here that whatever condition we are in, if we put this condition in the hand of God, at the end, it will end up as victory, as triumph. Even if it is a sin, even if there is a sin controlling me, when I put this in the hand of Christ, God will change this into triumph. That's what we say in the Gregorian liturgy. We say what? We say, you, O Master, have turned the punishment for me into salvation. You have turned the punishment for me into salvation. If you think about the sin of Adam and Eve, actually, is it fall or triumph? Is it defeat or triumph? Yes, it's defeat, it's fall. We cannot contradict this. But when we put this sin in the hand of God, God changed it into triumph. Yeah. If Adam and Eve did not sin, so they will be like human being, innocent, godly, and that's it, and living with God. But after actually the fall, what happened? God became man, and he took our human nature and united with him. Then, when he restored us, he did not restore us to our first estate, but he restored us actually to a much better estate than our first estate. Our first estate were just a human being, innocent, godly, and that's it. But we were not one with God, we were not united with God. But after the sin of Adam and Eve, actually now we are one with God, we are united. He took what's ours and he gave us what is his. As St. Paul said, when sin abounds, also grace of God abounds. So, even the sin of Adam and Eve, when God intervened, God actually changed this sin into triumph. Because he restored us not to our first state, but much better than our first state, to be one with God, to be his body, his sanctuary, carrying his Holy Spirit in our hearts. That's why St. Paul, in all situations, he considers it as a triumph. He looks beyond the here and now situation. Look beyond this and see how God will intervene, and then he will change this defeat into triumph. That's why all the time he never felt defeated within. Because he is so sure that when God enters our life, he will change this defeat or fall into victory. That's what God does all the time. Even in sin, yes, even in sin. Let me give you another example. Again, in the same letter, in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Verse 6. He told them, sorry, verse 8. For we do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, of our trouble which came to us in Asia, that we were burdened beyond the measure, above strength, so that we despaired even of life. When St. Paul, this very, very strong man, says, even we despair even of life, this means it's a very serious trouble. Actually, St. Paul said, I fell into despair. Yet, how St. Paul resolved this? He was actually in despair. There is no hope. He became hopeless. But how St. Paul, in this despair, actually looked beyond this despair and saw the victory of Christ, the triumph of Christ. He resolved this by very, very good way. He said, if I am desperate of life, then I am what? Dead. But can Christ raise a dead person from the dead? Yes, he did. He raised Lazarus after 4 days in grave. So even if we are despaired even to of life, but God can raise us from this death. The dead man cannot do anything. Lazarus couldn't do anything. If you compare any miracle of healing and the miracle of Lazarus, In a miracle of healing, the Lord Jesus Christ asked the person, do you want to be healed? Or we see the person running after Jesus Christ like Bartimaeus the blind. Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me and heal my arms. But Lazarus, even he couldn't speak, he couldn't cry, he couldn't say, Jesus help me. He's dead. But even if I am in a situation in which I am dead, I am desperate, I am hopeless, I cannot even cry like Lazarus in the tomb. I cannot even call on God to help me. But if God is there and if God intervened in my life, He can deliver me from such death as He delivered Lazarus from such death. So St. Paul at that time he said, yes, now I'm very desperate and I'm hopeless. But I am dead. But God actually can raise me from the death. So I'm not worried. Because Christ will raise me from this death. That's exactly what he said. He said, so that we despaired even of life. Verse 9, yes, we had the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God who raises the dead. Because I cannot do anything. I cannot trust myself. I cannot say even, I will cry. I will say, help me, save me. Even I cannot say this. So now all my trust in God who raises the dead, who delivered us from so great a death, and does deliver us, in whom we trust that He will still deliver us. See, St. Paul used here deliver in the three tenses. He who delivered us, that's the past tense, and does deliver us, that's the present tense, in whom we trust that He will still deliver us, He will, in the future. So He delivered, He does deliver, and He will deliver. So even in such desperate situation, in which St. Paul had no hope at all, he was desperate even of life, but he said, now in this situation, I cannot put trust in myself, but I will trust God, who raised from the dead, and God will raise me. He delivered, and He does deliver, and He will deliver. That's why he said, thanks be to God, who always leads us in triumph in Christ. Even if I am dead, yes, because Jesus can raise from the dead. So even if I'm dead and I cannot do anything, Jesus can raise me from the dead. Third instance in the life of St. Paul. Illness and diseases. St. Paul had disease in his eye, had ulcers in his eyes, and these ulcers actually produced pus and with bad smell. And I'm sure you understand, disease like this can be an obstacle to the ministry of St. Paul. He cannot see, he cannot write. And actually, he used some people to dictate his letters to them, to write down his letters. Traveling from one place to another place will not be easy. Besides, people will get offended when they smell, you know, the bad smell of the pus that comes from his eyes, from his ulcers. And that's the thorn in the flesh that St. Paul spoke about. And St. Paul actually prayed to God. He could, as any human being, we can consider this disease or this illness a defeat in ministry, a step backward in ministry. But for St. Paul, no, he did not consider it a step backward in ministry. He prayed to God. He said in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9, verse 8, concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me, and he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. So, how St. Paul would react to this? To this defeat, to this failure in his health. His health is failing. How can it? In what way he can see triumph here? Actually, that's how St. Paul resolved. He said, if I have good health, actually, maybe I will trust my health and my strength. But as the Lord told him, my grace is made perfect in weakness. So when I am weak, the grace of God will be abundant with me. So if when I am weak, the grace of God will increase, that's what I want. Because I don't want to serve with my ability. I want to serve with the grace of God. That's why I rejoice in my weakness. This is actually a triumph for me. Because in my weakness, the grace of God will increase, then the ministry will be better and better. That's exactly what he said. He said, therefore, most gladly I will rather boast in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Most gladly I boast in my infirmities. Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecution, in distress, for Christ's sake, for when I am weak, then I am strong. So, when I am in need, when I am stressed out, when I am in reproach, when I am in persecution, when I am distressed, this means the grace of God is increasing with me, is abounding me. Then, when I am weak, I am strong. So, I rejoice. Most gladly, I boast in my infirmity. St. Paul was very, very strange in the way, not strange in a negative way, but in a positive way, how he was able to see triumph, victory in every situation. When there is sin and division in the church, he saw triumph in it. When there was problems and depression from inside, to the extent that he felt desperate and hopeless. But he said, if I am dead, Christ will raise me. In illness, also he felt the triumph. Even in hardships. And I give you example of illness, example of sin, example of depression from within. What about hardships from outside? Even in hardships from outside, St. Paul perceived it as victory. When he was in the prison in Rome, in his first imprisonment. Some people, when they heard that St. Paul is in prison, they became so active in ministry. But some people became so active, actually, out of love to St. Paul. He said, St. Paul now is in prison, so when he hears that we are preaching the word of God, St. Paul will be very, very happy. But others, actually, they start to preach in order to add affliction to St. Paul. Because these people, the other group, they were preaching, you need to keep the Jewish law in order to be saved, the last Christianity. And St. Paul, when he was outside prison, he put them in their place. So they were like, cannot preach. They couldn't preach. But now St. Paul is in prison, so they took their freedom and started to preach in order to add affliction to St. Paul. And St. Paul, in his prison, heard that those people are preaching. If I am in the situation of some poor, maybe I will consider this as a failure, as a defeat. After I put them in their place, and actually I protected the church from this false teaching that you need to keep all the Jewish law in order to be saved, now these people are very free to preach. So all what I built now, it's destroyed now. We can perceive it as what? As a defeat. But listen what St. Paul said here in his prison. He said in chapter 1, Philippians chapter 1, verse 12, "But I want you to know, brethren, that the things which happened to me have actually turned out for the furtherness of the gospel." He said, being in prison, this turned out to the furtherness, advancement of the gospel. How? He said, "Most of the brethren in the Lord, having become confident by my chains, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preach Christ even from envy and strife, and some also from goodwill. The former preach Christ for self-ambition, not sincerely, supposing to add affliction to my chains, but the latter out of love, knowing that I am appointed for the defense of the gospel. What then? Only in that way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached. And in this I rejoice, yes, and will rejoice." Again, St. Paul speaking here in the past, in the present tense and the future. "I rejoice now and I will rejoice." So he's so confident that everything will end up with good ending. And that's why he say, "Now I rejoice and I will rejoice." What makes you believe this? In verse 19 he said, "For I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ." Actually, St. Paul was expecting a sentence of death from Nero, from Nero at that time. But St. Paul, he understand actually the will of God. So he said, now people are preaching, you need to keep the Jewish law in order to be saved. And definitely Christ is not happy by this. So Christ will deliver me from the prison because the people in Philippi still need me right now. That's why he is so sure that God will deliver him. As he said, "I know that this will turn out for my deliverance." And he explained clearly in verse 23. He said, "Don't think that I'm happy that I will be delivered in prison. This is not the reason of my happiness. But I am happy because God will use me to confirm the true faith." That's why in verse 23 he told them, "I am hard pressed between the two." There are two options, two choices, and I'm hard pressed between the two. First choice, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far, far better. Actually, if Neron signed the sentence of death today, and I'll be martyred today, I'll be very happy. I'll be with Christ. This is far better. Nevertheless, to remain in the flesh and to be delivered is more needful for you. And being confident of this, I know that I shall remain in the flesh and continue with you all for your progress and joy of faith, that your rejoicing for me may be more abundant in Jesus Christ by my coming to you again. St. Paul actually is seeing triumph in everything. Even those people who start to preach Christ from envy and strife, St. Paul, he said, Christ actually will change this into the furtherness of the gospel and my deliverance. That's why I rejoice and I rejoice. And that's exactly what happened. Actually, Neron did not kill him in this prison, and he was delivered after this. Even in the last letter that he wrote before his martyrdom, second letter to Timothy, a person who is just knowing he's dying, think about a person who has like a terminal disease and he knows he has just a few days and he will die. Maybe if he has terminal disease, it will be different, but St. Paul actually, he didn't have a terminal disease. He knew that he would be martyred, he would be killed. And he sent his letter to Timothy. And most of the people, they feel defeated before death. I mean, most of the people, when they know they have terminal disease or they are going to die, most of them, they feel defeated before death. But St. Paul actually didn't feel defeated before death. When he said to Timothy, telling him that he is dying or he will be martyred, listen to his words. He told him, "For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which is the Lord of righteous, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearance." So actually, St. Paul is saying here, this is the time of graduation. See how the student is very happy during the moment of his graduation. So St. Paul actually looked beyond the death and the martyrdom, and he said, now I'm graduated. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race, I have kept the faith, and now I will receive the crown of righteousness. I am looking for this crown of righteousness all my life. So this is actually a very joyful moment of my life. This is again a triumph. So when there was a sin, St. Paul looked beyond it as a triumph. When there was a depression and despair, St. Paul looked beyond it as a triumph. When there was illness, St. Paul looked beyond it as a triumph. When there was hardship from outside and imprisonment, St. Paul looked beyond it as a triumph. And when there was death, St. Paul looked beyond it as a triumph. That's why he said, "Thank be to God, who always, always leads us in triumph in Christ." He was never defeated. But let me conclude by saying, is there any theological foundation, or just St. Paul was an optimistic person? And maybe some people say St. Paul was optimistic, that's why he looked at everything in an optimistic way. And he can see some goodness, or there's goodness in everything. Is there any theological foundation for this or not? Actually, St. Paul explained to us the theological foundation in Romans chapter 8. Why we are victorious all the time, and always we are in this procession of triumph. Even when we are defeated, even when there is hopelessness, even when we are dead. Why? Triumph and victory here is reality. It's not just imagination or just being optimistic. Listen to what he said in Romans chapter 8. He said, number one, "For we know that all things work together for good to those who love God." All things. He didn't say in most of the cases. He didn't say in majority of cases. He didn't say almost always, but he said all things, all things. Whether it is disease, whether it is death, whether it is despair and hopelessness, whether it is sin, whether it is hardship, anything and all things in hand of God can be will work together for good. God can change anything for my good. That's why I feel always that I am walking in this procession of triumph. The second theological foundation here, St. Paul said, who are called according to his purpose, all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. So St. Paul said God is calling us. Like if you start a project or start a business, you will do more than your best to make this business or project succeed. Nobody start a project and then just compromise it very easily. In the same way, God will never give up on us. God actually invested in us many, many things. He invested himself, he invested his blood. He purchased us with his blood. And this is a very, very high price. Do you think after all this investment, God just will let us go kill it? Without, you know, or perish without saving us? Absolutely not. So we are in the procession of triumph because God has called us. God has called us. But you may argue and say, and St. Paul actually confirming this in verse 32 when he said, he who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Do you think there is something more precious for God the Father more than his son? Never. Nothing at all. So if he did not spare his son, do you think he would not give us everything else? Definitely he will. But you may argue and say, but what about Satan? Satan is making a big accusation against us. So what will happen here? And before I read it, just I want to give you the scenario that St. Paul explained here. And this scenario actually never exists on earth. What's the scenario? If you are arrested in a big trial and all the evidences are against you, who is the prosecutor here? Thomas, all respect to the prosecutor, but it's Satan actually who is holding charges against us. That's the prosecutor. Who's the judge? It is Jesus Christ. Who's the lawyer? It's very important to know. Who's the lawyer? The lawyer here is also Jesus Christ. And in any earthly setting, the lawyer cannot be the judge. So, do you think a lawyer, if the lawyer is the judge, do you think any lawyer wants to lose, you know, a case like this? He's a judge. That's what St. Paul is saying in this verse. Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? Do you think Satan will dare to bring a charge against us? It is God who justifies. He is the judge. Who is he who condemns? Who will justify or condemn? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen. So the judge is the lawyer. And the lawyer already, he won the case on the cross. He died and also risen. Who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Makes intercession for us means what? He is our lawyer. So actually, you should not worry about losing your kids. Christ is there. Christ is interceding before the Father all the time. That's why St. Paul said, thanks be to God, who always, always leads us in triumph in Christ. That's why he said, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Usually you understand this verse, who stopped me from loving Christ. But actually, in this context, the verse doesn't mean this. The verse, who can keep me away or withdraw me from the love of Christ? Christ is loving me all the way, and nobody can separate me from this love. No power can separate me from, even the power of Satan cannot separate me from the power of love of Christ. Shall tribulation, shall distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Nothing. And then he spoke about the heavenly principalities, Satan and all his power. He said, for I am persuaded, I am 100% sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And as I told you, this doesn't mean who will stop me from loving Christ, but this actually means who can stop Christ from loving me and save me. No power. That's why he said, God, thanks be to God, who always leads us in triumph in Christ. That's why we have to have this spirit of triumph and spirit of victory. We are in the procession of triumph and victory. We are in this procession not because we are good, but because God loved us. Not because we are worthy, but it is because of his grace. He chose us and he died for us in order to save us. So that's why, regardless of circumstances surround us, regardless if there is hardship from outside or pain from inside, whether there is illness or there is death, whether there is sin, I have to be sure if I turn to Christ, Christ can change all things to work together for good to those who love him. Glory be to God forever.